Vice, are you standing up?
Can do. Try. I have a chair to support myself with.
Okay. Well, if you need to sit down, let me know and I'll give you some guidance on what to do sitting down. Okay. We'll try this and see how it goes. So as soon as you feel like you need to sit down, anybody, just sit down and then I'll talk you through it as soon as I can. So we're going to start with our feet parallel. I've got my red socks on today, so hopefully you can see my feet. But we do have that Parkinson's Care and Support UK over the top of them. But there we go. Your toes should be pointing forwards. So that's what we mean by feet parallel. And they should be what you think is shoulder width apart. So if you look down at them and then sort of follow it up, hopefully they're underneath your shoulders roughly. Too wide, and it looks like you're doing sumo. Too narrow, and you're doing yoga. So it's shoulder width apart. Okay, we're going to bring the weight forwards into the balls of the feet. So all you've got to do is just move a little bit of a change, a little bit of a lean, if you like, in the ankles, so that the weight comes into the balls of the feet. What I mean by that is your weight is centered on the balls of the feet. Once you've got your weight in the balls of the feet, you've got anchor points that you can lift the toes up from. So I'm just lifting my toes up now, but if it was my fingers, I'd be lifting them up like that. And then just gently stretch them. Now, if you can't stretch them, if you think, well, I don't know how to do that, just imagine what it would feel like if you could, if you can get your head around that one. So just imagine them stretching if you can't actually do it. And then place down the big toes first. So just place them down, but keep that gentle stretch. And then follow them with all the rest of the toes, two by two, until you get to the little toes. So you've kind of created this sort of ripple movement around the front of your feet. Make that ripple movement carry on, so it goes around the outside edge of the feet and into the heels, so that everything, you're just kind of like making sure that it's secure with the ground and you have a reasonably good arch, a good structure in the feet. What is that noise? That's better. No. Okay, keep that structure in your feet and then see if you can soften the muscles in the legs a little bit. So you're just trying to let them relax a little bit. Obviously, if you let them relax completely, you're going to be in a puddle on the floor, but just soften them off. What happens is the deeper muscles take over. Some people call them intrinsic muscles. I haven't yet studied anatomy physiology to that level of detail to find out what they are, but I know that they're there. So we're just softening off the big muscles. Now that you've got soft legs, stretch the spine. So just try and lift the head up a little bit. So bringing the head on top of the shoulders and just lifting it upwards. Keeping the shoulders and the arms soft. So because you soften the legs, gravity is pulling the pelvis a little bit more than normal, or at least you can feel the pull. And so this gravitational pull is moving into the lower back, into the lower spine, around about here. So you can actually create an opposite force, you know, got opposing forces by just lifting the head up, just creating a stretch. Now the pièce de la résistance is to move the pelvis backwards a little bit, so it's vertically above the heels, and then lean forwards from the hips. That takes the body weight out of the lower back and shifts it forwards, so it goes from here forwards into the abs. And then the back opens a little bit more, the smaller the back will open a little bit more, just naturally. So you don't have to do anything, which is great. But keep the head on top of the shoulders. Everybody okay so far?
Yeah.
Yeah? Now, if you've got your forward lean correct, then your hands will be just a little bit in front of the legs, assuming that your arms are just dangling there like a pair of curtains. Yeah. If they're resting against the legs, then your forward lean is a little bit shallow. There's not enough there. And if they're sort of all the way out here, then you're leaning too far forwards and you're probably going to fall over. So just keep it subtle, yeah, but there. Now then, what we have here is yin in the legs and yang in the upper part of the body. We're creating a nice stretch in the upper part of the body. We're opening the joints, this string of joints that we call the spine. They're kind of, in Tai Chi, they're the most important joints in your body for doing Tai Chi. But there's other ones as well. The next two important ones are the hips. So we're going to try and keep this stretch of the spine. It's a gentle opening, really. And there's nothing too vigorous going on. And at the same time, we're going to start to loosen off the hip joints by just pivoting the pelvis, yeah? Let the shoulders follow the pelvis. Don't let the pelvis follow the shoulders. So it's about the pelvis. So if you can't move your pelvis, then I would expect to not see you moving. So you don't have to be, it doesn't have to be a massive movement. It can be if you want it to be. It can just be a subtle movement, just a little one. What's important really is that you move and also that you keep the knees pointing in the same directions as the toes. Mm. That's really important. So if the knee starts to fold in like that, then you're putting a sideways pressure on the knee, which is not so good for the ligaments of the knee. Keep it nice and strong. The other thing about it is if you're keeping your knee pointing that way, you're creating more of a stretch in the hip joint. The reason why the knee pulls in is because your hip joint doesn't want to open. So you just got to relax that hip joint a little bit more and let it open a little bit more. And if the knee still folds in, well, just don't turn the pelvis quite so far. So what's happening here is more yin and yang. You know, we've got yin in the legs, we've got yang in the upper body, and now we have this ever-changing yin and yang in the pelvis. So, you know, your left hip is becoming more and more yin, and then less and less yin, more and more yang, and it's just forever changing, circling through. So yin and yang tends to be considered to be a sort of a new age sort of profound philosophy, but we're just applying it to movement of the body. And that's it for now. We also apply it to movement of the subtle body, if you want to take it that far. Okay, someone's trying to come in, so if you could just carry on for a moment, and I'm just going to walk over and let this person in. It's Sergio. We can't let him miss the class. Okay. So just let yourself come to a rest, but you're still standing in this sort of beginning posture, beginning stance, which is called Wuji. Wuji San Suan. Now then, I'm going to try something. I'm going to try something. If you can't do it, don't worry, just carry on doing what we were doing before. I'm going to add an extra ingredient to this hip opening. Now, which way can I do this? In fact, if I step backwards, I don't know if you can see my feet. You probably can just about see my feet. But what I'm going to get you to do is pivot on a heel. So as my pelvis turns, or my navel turns this way, then I pivot on that heel. So I'll just lift the toes up and turn the foot on the heel. And then as my navel comes back again, I bring the foot back until it's pointing forwards. And then I swap sides and pivot on the other side. And then I swap sides again. If you can do this, do it. If you can't, just carry on with the easy way by keeping your feet still. So we're just pivoting on the heels. And if you are managing to pivot on the heel, you'll probably notice, I certainly am, that your foot's a bit sticky. It's kind of sticking to the ground, the one that should be turning. If that's the case, see if you can shift the weight more onto the leg that's not turning, more onto the foot that's not turning, and sink down in it a little bit. So you just let that leg soften a little bit more. And hopefully you'll find then that the foot turns a lot easier because you've got no weight in it. It's this whole thing about shifting weight again, which is part of the reason why I'm getting you guys to do it. So just think about what you're doing. Take it steady. There's no rush. What I want you to do really is to sort of try to focus in your mind into particular parts of the body. We want you to concentrate on that if you can. So think about the balls of the feet, for example. The foot that you're standing on at any point in time, you should really still have your weight centered on the ball of the foot. And you should still have this good structure in the foot. So you're sinking down through the ball of the foot. Now, whether or not you're getting it right, it doesn't matter. It really doesn't matter. The important thing is actually focusing on it. Now, people say that Tai Chi is very relaxing. But it's also, you know, it's very detailed. You're sort of going into sort of detailed minutiae of movements and getting an understanding of what how it should be and also understanding what you need to do to change, you know, sort of a gradual change. And if you get sort of het up on your body not doing what you're asking it to do, it's not relaxing. You sort of just get stressed out. So we just want to forgive, allow your body to do what it's choosing to do, and experiment and explore and see how you change what you're trying to do so that it does actually do what you want it to do, if that makes sense. Good. Right, before we shake out, quick question for you. So I said that the spine joints are the most important joints, and then the second most important joints are the hip joints. What do you think the third most important joints are? Any ideas? Neck, shoulders, because the neck's kind of part of the spine. Well, not kind of, it is. It's part of the spine. So all of that is really important, very important. But then the shoulders. Why? Well, the hips and the shoulders are, as you've just said, Martin, they're the things that take our weight. They do all the work. You know, when we're standing up, the hips are bearing our weight. When we're lifting, when we're working, when we're typing on the keyboard, when we're doing the gardening, or whatever, the shoulders are doing all the work. So we want to try and loosen those up. I've got a nice, easy exercise for you to loosen up the shoulders. Now, if you need to sit down now, it's okay to do this sitting down. If you don't need to sit down, it's also really great to do it standing up. So it's entirely up to you. I'm going to do it standing up because, mainly because I don't actually have any seats other than these settees, but they're not going to work very well for me. I am going to move a little bit closer so you can see what I'm doing there. So we're carrying on standing in this Wu Chi stance, and we're carrying on keeping the arms just sort of soft. And what I'd like you to do is keeping the neck stretched, so you've got to focus in on the neck a little bit, otherwise you'll start moving the neck around. Try and shrug the shoulders, so try and move the tops of the shoulders on so that they touch your earlobes. You won't succeed, by the way, but try. But also try and move your earlobes away from them by stretching the neck. Good. Okay, and then relax the shoulders back down again. So just really do relax them and let them go. And then try to move the shoulders down so that the fingertips touch the floor. Again, you're not going to succeed, but it's good to aim high, or in this case low, so that you can really move towards as far as you can go, actually, is what the explanation I'm looking for. The shoulders are sort of moving down. And again, you sort of relax them so they will come back up again to their sort of natural resting place, but then lift them up again. So keep stretching the neck, keep stretching the neck, lifting the head up. And try and touch the earlobes again with the shoulders. And then relax the shoulders again. Let them go back to their natural resting place. And then move them down. Try and make the fingertips touch the ground. Let them come back to the normal resting place, and then lifting them up again to try to touch the earlobes. Fantastic. And then letting them come back down to their natural resting place. And one more go, one more. Just moving them down to try to make the fingertips touch the floor. Again, you're still stretching the spine, you're still stretching the neck. Keeping the head on top of the shoulders. Everyone's looking good. And then let the shoulders come back to their natural resting place. So that's that plane. We're going to do this plane now. So see if you can make the shoulders touch each other behind your back. So you're sort of moving them backwards and round. You should feel your shoulder blades kind of trying to touch by doing this. Also, as you're doing this, try to let the sternum area relax. So you'll find that the sternum area, if it's tight or tense, it will stop the shoulders from going as far back as they can. So also at the same time, just sort of pay a little bit of attention to the sternum and see if you can make that relax. As that relaxes, you'll feel possibly either the need to cry, to scream, to shout, or to smile. One of those things. Whatever you've got stored up in there, really. And then just bring them back to their natural resting place and then keep going so that you try and make them touch in front of you. When you do this, there's a tendency to want to do this with the head, so try to avoid that. Try and keep the head on top of the shoulders. And you can, if you want to, just cuddle the shoulders a little bit. So it's not forcing them, but it's just encouraging them, if you like, coaxing them towards each other a little bit, but not too vigorous. Again, try and keep the chest area relaxed so it just allows them to move more. And then you can just let go of that and let it all come back to its natural resting place. And then carry on going round. Try and bring them behind you again. Again, keeping the head on top of the shoulders or on top of where the shoulders should be. Try and touch them together. If you're getting any kind of sensation in your hands from this, that's a natural response. If you're not, that's also a natural response. So don't worry too much, but I'm just wanted to bring your attention to that possibility. Again, bring them forwards again, and you can cuddle them in. I just got a great big crack on mine. That's kind of normal. If you get a bit of a crack, it's okay. That's just fluid moving around in the joints. And again, let them just relax back to the normal resting place. How many times have we done that? Twice. We'll do one more on each side. So again, moving them back so that they touch behind. And then moving them back forwards again. Gently, gently. So it really is a cuddle. You're cuddling yourself. You're letting yourself know that you're loved, rather than, right, you're going to get together, you two. You know, it's more of a gentle thing. Okay, and then we'll just let them relax again, back to their normal resting place. Everybody okay? There's one last bit to this exercise. I'd like you to, now that you've done all of those places, having a mental note of which bits were possibly the hardest, try and go there by circling the shoulders in whatever way you want to do. So your shoulders can circle if you can manage it independently, or you can have them going together in some way. But just circling and going to all those places and then everywhere in between as well. And in any direction you want to as well, and maybe changing directions every now and then, going in opposite directions perhaps, or in the same direction as one another, whatever works. And again, if you're anything like me, you'll be getting some kind of sensation in your hands. But again, if you don't, it doesn't matter. It's not, that's not our goal. It's just something that you might notice. Very good. Now I'm going to get you to shake out. So first of all, to shake out the hands. So just to remind you, again, you're standing in Wuji. You bring the shoulders forward a bit, not as far as we were just doing, but just enough so that you can cross the arms. So the left arm is on top of the right arm. And they're crossing roughly in front of the midline of the body. And then you just shake. The shake should be coming from the shoulders. There's, again, it's nothing vigorous, it's just a movement. And the arms are sort of just lolloping about a bit, really. And then it really comes through to the hands, if you can. So you're kind of like sending pulses down the arms, sort of waves. You're sort of letting them ripple down the arms right the way to the fingertips. Very good. Now we need to shake out the feet. So find something that is secure that you can lean on. Stand on one leg. I'm going to move back a bit so you can see what I'm doing. Stand on one leg and just lift the other foot slightly off the floor and move it forwards a bit. Lift the toes up so you're kind of tilting at the heel and then stretch out of the hip joint down the back of the leg as best you can. So you're kind of like trying to shift the heel in towards the ground by creating a nice stretch down the back of the leg. Once you've got that stretch in place, that's the most important bit. See if you can jiggle it as well at the same time. If you can't, it doesn't matter. The stretch is the thing that does all the work. The jiggle is more of an icing on the cake. And then the same on the other side. I think now, once you've finished doing this shake, now is a good time to have a sip of drink if you've got one. I'm going to have a sip. Bing! Is everybody okay?
Yes.
Good. We'll just let Penny and John come back. I'll have another sip. Now, my recommendation to you folks is not to drink cold water, but obviously it's your choice. But you're bringing cold into the body if you drink cold water, so it's best not to drink cold, especially at this time of year.
How hot? Lukewarm or hot?
Just not cold. Yeah, I'm not going to get too strict about it. It's just, you know, if you've taken ice into your body, you're sort of bringing cold into the digestive system. It's not very good for you, really. People do it to slow down the digestive system, which is exactly what it does. But that has a different effect than what you think it might have. But according to traditional Chinese medicine, you know, you shouldn't be bringing cold into the body. You should have a homeostasis, you know, it should be warm, but not hot. You know, if you drink boiling hot tea, you're going to scald your insides. So, but we know that, don't we? It's the ice thing that we're not so sure about, I think. Yeah, so if I have an ice cream, you know, I'll let the ice cream melt in my mouth before I swallow it. Which you've got to do anyway, because you've got to enjoy the flavour as much as possible. I digress. Okay, so we've done hips, we've done spine, we've done shoulders. Now we're going to do some moving around a little bit, yeah? I'm always scared about repeating the same stuff, but I kind of feel like it's really important that we do. So, if you're starting to get bored, let me know. But I think that actually you're probably appreciating, repeating the same exercise a few times so that you can get your head around it and see how you're progressing with it. So over the past few weeks, we've been doing this walking exercise. And because Violet's new, I'm going to give you another explanation, but we all, I think, benefit from hearing the same thing over and over again, because I never say it the same twice. So it's always useful to hear it said different ways. And the premise is this, you're back home late. Everybody else in the house is asleep. And aside from the creaky floorboards, which we can't do anything about, you want to minimize your foot the noise of your footsteps as much as possible. And the way that you do that is to make sure that you don't put weight in your foot when it's not on the ground or not on the floor. So I'm just going to demonstrate to you. I'm going to start off in this Wuji stance, roughly. I'm going to shift my weight across to my right foot, which I'm doing now. And then I'm going to lift the left foot off the ground and step it forwards just a little bit, just about a foot length, so that the back of the heel of the left foot is just in front of where the right toes are. I'm not crossing them over, but in terms of direction forwards. And once it's touching the ground, I'm then going to move my weight forwards into it. And in fact, I'm going to move all my weight into it, gradually, slowly, until I can release the right foot off the ground because there's no longer any weight in it. Now, I'm quite good at standing on one leg because I do it a lot. You might want to just make sure you move your foot forwards quite quickly. Not panicking about it, but and then just placing it down without any weight in it again. So your weight is still in, this time the left leg, and then shifting the weight forwards into the right foot. Lifting the left foot off the ground and placing that down, and then moving the weight into it. So the key thing is you don't put any weight in the foot while it's off the ground. You don't put any weight in the foot until it's on the floor. Have a go if you're not already having a go. It's almost like you're kind of trying to get in touch with the ground a bit more, or get more in touch with your carpet or your floor by sort of feeling it with the foot before you actually commit your weight into it. Again, you want to try to keep soft but firm structure in the foot. Okay, you can't see much now apart from my t-shirt. I'm going to turn around. You're going to see even less then. You can see the back of me. But that's the idea. When you get to the end of your room, when you get to a wall or obstruction, turn around and go back the other way. And it doesn't matter how far it is, as long as you can get a couple of steps in. Just, this is the beauty of turning around, isn't it? So I'm quite blessed. I've got quite a long lounge, so I can do this exercise with quite a few steps, but it doesn't actually matter. As long as you can get a couple of steps in, it's fine. So my hope is that what this will achieve for you is to strengthen the connection between the motor cortex and the muscles. All of the muscles that you need to use in order to walk. Let's keep going. Is everybody okay? Give me a nod or a thumbs up or whatever. Good, 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 good. soon as you finish your current route, and you find yourself back into your position in front of the camera, then is your opportunity to pause. Brilliant. Okay. Have a go at this if you can, and if you can't, carry on doing what we were just doing. But try turning, so this is my right foot, try turning your right foot out to the side, shifting the weight into it, and then stepping forwards about twice as far as you have been. Keeping the weight in the right foot. So rather than being here, you're all the way back here. See if you can turn the pelvis so that your navel is pointing in the same direction as your left toes, basically pointing forwards.
Hello, John. And I'm in the middle of exercises. Yeah, I've got one.
And let's have a little play with our weight. We're just going to shift the weight forwards into the left foot. Try to keep the navel pointing in the same direction as the left foot.
Okay, thank you, brother.
So your feet are exactly where they were. You've just moved the torso and the upper part of the body forwards, and then move it back again. So you can feel the weight, hopefully you can feel the weight, or at least you know that the weight is changing. You know, the percentage of weight between your feet is changing. Another way to look at it is if you've got a light above your head, like the ceiling is all light, then you'll have a shadow that's moving backwards and forwards between your feet. Okay, good. Try it on the other side. So turn the left foot out sideways. It needs to be about 80 degrees maximum. If it's a bit tough on the hip, you can turn it in so it's 45 degrees. If that means anything to you, hopefully we all know what that is, but about half of a right angle. If you can, get it closer to a right angle. And again, try and get the pelvis. What we're doing is we're trying to get the pelvis square so that the navel is pointing forwards, and try and keep the pelvis where it is. Weight's back in the left foot. And then we're just going to shift the weight gradually out of the left foot and into the right foot, just by moving the body forwards and then moving it back again. As you do this, try to keep your head level. So rather than going, what some people do this, I'm not saying any of you do this, but I have seen it in the past, rather than doing that, so by fixing your eyes on a object on the wall or something, you can just make sure that it doesn't move up and down in your vision. And then you'll know that you're keeping your head's level. And remember, the head needs to be on top of the shoulders. Head is about a third of your body weight. So if you don't have it on top of the shoulders, it shifts your center of gravity out of your safety zone, if you like, the safety zone between your feet. That's another reason why people slip over on ice. We were having a discussion about falling over on ice last week, I think.
Yeah.
So if your head is forwards, then it takes your center of gravity off center, and you're much more likely to go. Okay, let's add something to this. And again, if this is too much for you, just let me know, and I'll give you a modification to it. So bring the weight back into the back foot, into the left foot, and then pivot on the heel of the front foot so that the front foot turns out to the side. Shift the weight across and forwards so it goes into it. Make sure that your leg is soft, so you sink into the leg and the knee is over the toes. Otherwise, you're going to damage your knee. And then just bring the other foot through and forwards. Is that okay? I know I'm pushing you a bit here, but I thought I'd give it a go and see how you get on. And then again, we can shift the weight backwards and forwards between the feet. I'm going to let you into a little secret here. What we're doing here is quite advanced Tai Chi. Although we haven't done any of these nice flowing movements that you see, this is stuff that people go back to once they've learned a form and try to master. So we're doing quite, it's a very interesting exercise, and it becomes more interesting as you become more familiar with it. Or at least it becomes more intellectually interesting. But for now, it's still having the same effect for you. Okay, again, bringing the weight back into the back foot. So this time it's your right foot, I hope. So make sure that that foot's taking all of your weight. And then pivot on the heel, the front foot. So just to turn the foot out, to turn the toes out. And then place it down the ground. And again, very, very carefully, shift the weight forwards and across to the side, making sure that your knee is pointing in the same direction as the toes, so that you've got a good secure support in the knee. Soften the leg. The more you soften the leg, the more it will take your weight, believe it or not. If you have the weight hard, stressed, if you like, you're more likely to fall over. And then bring the foot through, the other foot, the right foot, and step it forwards again. I could do with the camera on the ceiling so that you can see what my feet are doing. One of the days I'll get it rigged up. I don't think the wife would be very happy about that though. I got a camera rigged up on the ceiling. Yeah. We don't have a ceiling rose. If we had a ceiling rose, that would work quite nicely. So again, you're shifting the weight backwards and forwards, keeping the navel pointing in the same direction as the toes, the front toes, the front knee. So getting your footing right when you're doing Tai Chi is so, so important. Everything goes horribly wrong if you get your footing wrong, and it's so easy to do to get your footing wrong. One more time, if you can, if you've got space. So bringing the weight back into the left foot this time and pivoting on the heel of the right foot to turn the toes out to the side, placing it down on the ground. Once you've got a secure footing, very carefully, slowly, gently, softly, shifting the weight across and forwards into it, making sure your knee is pointing in the same direction as the toes, the knees turning out. If you need to turn the pelvis, so be it. Just make sure your knee's over your toes. That's really important. Once you've got the weight in that foot, you can lift the other foot off the ground and step it through. Wow. Fantastic. Have another shakeout, folks. So standing back in Wuji, rounding the shoulders forwards, the arms cross point to the midline of the body. Shake the hands out. Why? The theory is this. You've just been connecting with the ground and moving the connection between your feet. The theory is that we have a earth chi, ground chi, coming into the body. But it only comes in if you pump it in. And the process that we were just doing is pumping it into the body. That pushes toxins out of the body into the hands. So we're shaking out the hands to finish that process off as best you can. Then finding a secure object to just take the weight a little bit. Take a leg and stretch down from the bum through to the heel, lifting the toes up. So I'm doing my left leg at the moment. My left foot's off the ground, left toes are trying to point up towards the ceiling, and the heel's trying to point into the ground. Once I've got a good stretch, then just jiggle. So the jiggle action is kind of going up and down. Same on the other side. Good. Is everybody okay? Give me a thumbs up if you are. Fantastic. Have a sip of water, tea, whatever it is you happen to have to hand. Sergio, we can't see you, but I'm relying on you just joining in. So we're doing quite a bit of work now on the legs and the feet. We did get the shoulders loosened off. I want us to do something with the hands and fingers and arms as well now. So, and this requires us to go into Tai Chi. Remember Tai Chi? So Tai Chi is rather a lot like Wu Chi. So you start off in Wu Chi and then sink the legs. To get it perfectly right, breathe in and just let the hands rise up so that you're... So this isn't a vigorous stretch. It can be if you want it to be, but the hands are just risen up to about shoulder level. And you're just gently opening, you're just gently lengthening the arms right the way from the shoulder blades through to the fingertips. So you've got a straight line of stretch. In fact, it's five straight lines. You know, your left thumb has a line going from it to the right thumb, in your imagination at least, and so on for all of your fingers. Change that line to a spiral by just rotating the hands and allowing them to come down. See, now you've got spirals coming down like that. Yeah. The fingers are kind of like at right angles to one another, pointing up a little bit. See, it kind of looks like you're leaning on a pair of those, you know, those walking sticks you can get that open out, they've got a little seat on. Like a sort of stall type thing. Like you're leaning on a pair of them, or just ordinary walking sticks, you know, your mountaineering sticks, just leaning on the tops of them, provided they're that high, which I guess they're not. They're not really taller than that, aren't they, I think. So the hands are just in front of the hip joints. The head is back on top of the shoulders so that the chest area can open nicely. Okay. There's more details, but I'm going to leave it at that for now. I think this is good. What you're going to do is we're going to rotate the hands slowly and move them apart. You'll see what I mean. I'll give you a demonstration. So as I rotate the hands, whichever fingers are pointing forwards, I'm going to focus on them and just stretch them a little extra. It's not a vigorous stretch still, but it's just a little bit extra stretch. So I've got my little fingers forwards, they're stretching. Carry on rotating the hands until the ring fingers are pointing forwards and then focus in on them. Keep rotating until you get to the middle fingers. Keep rotating until you get the forefingers and then the thumbs. So when the thumbs are pointing forwards, then really try and move them forwards. So you're actually just moving, using the shoulder joints. And as you do so, rotate the arm and the shoulder joints so that the fingers turn down towards the ground, but the thumbs are still pointing forwards. And then just let them rise up. Try and keep the shoulders soft. So there's a tendency to try and lift them up with the shoulders. Keep the shoulders soft. This is a very strong exercise, folks, even though it might not feel like you're doing a lot of work. Just warning you. As soon as the hands get to shoulder level, rotate the arms again, so that the palms are more or less facing down to the ground. The palms are facing to the ground. And then just flex the wrist joints a little bit so the palms are away from you, but mostly to the ground. And then just allow them to come down. So it's a gentle push down through the hands, but an equal push up through the top of the head. Until they come back to where they started. Back to this Tai Chi position. Just in front of the hip joints. Fingers pointing out and up a little bit. Let me show you. So the fingers are kind of doing that. If that makes sense. But they're down here in front of the hip joints. We're going to do this at least two more times. So again, starting to rotate the hands until the little fingers, I don't call them the thumbs then, The little fingers are pointing forwards. Keep rotating until you get to the ring fingers. Let them point forwards a bit and stretch them. Rotate again until you get to the middle fingers. Stretch those. Then the four fingers. Stretch those. Keep going until the thumbs are just coming through and forwards and forwards and forwards and forwards and forwards. Rotating the arms so that the fingers point down. And then just allowing the hands to rise up. Until the hands get to shoulder height. When they're at shoulder height, rotate the arms again so that the palms of the hands are facing the floor. Okay, just at this moment, pause for a moment and check that your hands are shoulder width apart. If they're too close together, that's going to be constricting the chest area. So you want them at least shoulder width, and it's no harm to have them a bit wider if you want to, at least shoulder width. Flex the wrist a little bit so the palms are facing away from you slightly, but mostly towards the ground. And then again, a gentle push down and pushing up through the top of the head with an equal and opposite force. Keep smiling. One more, yeah? One more. Before I do, you can just hold it there for a moment if you want to. I just want to show you what's happening with the hand. So as I'm turning, I stretch the little finger, turn, stretch the ring finger, turn, stretch the middle finger, turn. So whichever finger's pointing forwards, I'm stretching. So now the forefinger. And then it's a bit of a while to get to the thumbs. I just keep turning the hand until the thumb is forwards and trying to send the thumb forwards. And as I do so, you let the arm go with it a bit. And as that happens, you can just rotate the arm so that the fingers turn into the ground. And then you just let it rise up. Of course, you've got to move it up with your muscles. You know, it's not just going to happen by magic, but you're not forcing it. There's no major effort involved. And you want to keep the shoulder soft. You do that on both sides. So we'll do that one more time. Okay, one. So little fingers, ring fingers, middle fingers, four fingers, and then the thumbs. Keep sending forwards for the thumbs. Rotate the arms so that the fingers then point into the ground. Keep sending the thumbs forwards. So this act of trying to send the thumbs forwards kind of causes the hands to rise up, or it feels like it does. Try and keep the shoulders soft so that they're not lifting the hands up. They're staying nice and soft. And the hands come to about level with the shoulders, no higher. And then rotate the arms in the opposite direction so that the palms are facing the ground. Flex the wrists ever so slightly so the palms are facing away from you. And then send down, but send up for the top of the head at the same time with an equal and opposite force. Very good. Very nice. Keep your hands off your body for the moment. Yeah? So if we go with this theory that you've got stuff coming out your hands, the last place you want it is back inside again. You've just done all that work to get it out. So, you know, unless you want to go and hug your worst enemy, best not to make any connection with yourself or anybody else with the hands just yet. So from here, we're going to rise back up again into Wu Ji, round the shoulders forward so the arms cross in front of the middle of the body, and shake the hands out. I really, really wanted to show you another thing, but we're kind of running out of time. So what I'd like to do, if you will permit me, is just show you what I was going to try and teach you, and we'll do it next week properly. But you can join in if you want to. So find yourself your secure object again, and make sure you shake the feet out. left foot, then the right foot, or the right foot, then the left foot. Everybody okay? Well, you can stand around and watch, you can sit down and watch, or you can have a go at see if you can copy me if you want to, your choice. Well, what I was going to show you is kind of like half of what we just did. So what we just did was doing this, yeah? But I'm only going to do it on the one side, on my right side. The other side, the left side, is just going to stay where it is. And at the same time as doing this stuff with the hand, I'm going to pivot on the heel of the foot. So perhaps you can't see my heel and you can't see the top of my head, but I think what's important is this part of the body and the hand, so that you can just see what I'm doing. And I'll talk you through what I'm doing with the bits that you can't see. Yeah, so we're starting off in Tai Chi. I shift my weight completely into my left foot and then turn at the same time as sending out through the fingers, just like we just did, until the right foot is facing sideways. So I have like a right angle between my feet. And then I carry on turning the arm in the usual way and shift the weight across onto my right foot. Yeah, so it's kind of, it's half of the first part of that exercise we just did, which incidentally is called the chest down in, or chest exercise. That's it, really. I'll show you again in full. So you just start here and you open out. And then you shift your weight across until you're there. So by the time I'm here, all my weight is in my right side. I can lift my left foot off the ground, provided I can stand on one leg. Yeah. So we'll do that properly next time, because I think we've run out of time now. However, I would like to spend a couple of minutes with you just making sure that you're all okay and getting any feedback. If you have anything you wanted to say, now is your opportunity. I'm just going to swap cameras so I can sit down.